I say that Dayle is my favorite graduate of the School of Jewish Communal Service at Hebrew Union College, among many of her other honors. And we are working with a small group at Kalsman right now in the area of Jewish healing, and we're studying leadership models. And I have to say that Dayle has come up on multiple occasions as a model of a leader for our community. And she is the most amazing balance of humble and proud. And we talked about those words just a minute ago around the room. And she is able to share what she's doing and promote her programs while also creating space for patients, clients, and colleagues to learn and really take in the information that she's going to share. So you can read, she will tell more about Hiddur, and you can read some more about her history on the paperwork, but I'm just very proud to have her here and to share some of her leadership with us.
I have to move this. I have a degree in social work. You have to move things around. So I just have to say that it is an incredible kavod to be here, and really thrilling to look around the room and see people whom I've known from my training and from my work in chaplaincy and my work in the rabbinate, and old friends and hopefully new ones as well. So thank you for the opportunity to learn together this afternoon. I want to begin by telling you what I learned at HUC. What I learned is, if you're looking at a prospective congregation and you want to determine the vitality of that congregation, you look at a ratio. Who knows what the ratio is? Anybody know? Number of kids in the religious school to number of member units. That's what I learned at HUC. So I'm hoping that we'll unlearn that today. Just a little bit. Why? Because if we continue to create a measure of success that's based only on chronological age in our congregations and in our community, we have doomed ourselves to maybe the feeling of failure, if not to failure itself. Why? Because the demographic reality of our community is that we are aging. And this is not a surprise to you. This is, I'm sure, who you see in your studies and the families with whom you are providing accompaniment through all of the passages of life. You're very well aware. We know that 19% of the Jewish community in the year 2000 was over 65, compared to 12% of the American population. But to me, that's not the most impressive statistic. More impressive, perhaps, is the fact that 23% of us are over 60. And that was obviously in the year 2000, before the leading edge of the baby boomers reached this year with great fanfare, the new 60s. So if you take 23% of us, or maybe a quarter of us, who are already officially in what I'll call later life, and then you add the generations before them who, or younger than they, who are caregiving, you can genuinely say, I think, that aging affects more than half of our community in some very immediate way. I once went to a conference of people in the aging field, and I was given a button that said, "Aging, aren't we all?" And I was a lot younger then. Now it feels a lot more immediate, I have to say. But I wanted to say also, just by way of introduction, that this cohort of people who are now old and the coming cohort of baby boomers who are on the threshold of later life, this is not your father Zeta. This is a very different cohort for which I think we are somewhat unprepared in terms of engaging and tapping the resources of these people. These are people who are more educated and sophisticated and less traditionally grounded in Judaism than the cohorts who came before. And we have a paradox, because elders are simultaneously a very significant backbone of most of our congregations, and at least a substantial number of them are either absent or invisible. We're going to explore together the needs and gifts of this vast segment of our community and look at how we might both spiritually engage them and tap their resources for Jewish communal life. By way of beginning, I want to introduce you to four individuals I've met in the course of my work in the past year or so, and all of them are part of the age wave. First, Stephen. He's 61 years old. He's retired from a prominent position in the entertainment industry. He travels often, skis passionately, but he's casting about for a focus for his energy when he's not on the road. When invited to speak about aging, he replies, "I don't like that word." He is not involved with his synagogue. Barbara is 75 years old. She's a retired attorney. She's active on several community boards and has many interests. Because of the downturn in the stock market, Barbara's currently looking for part-time employment. She's a regular at Shabbat services and Torah study in her congregation. She reports that she feels invisible in the congregation. In discussions, she feels that her voice is not heard. She would love to participate in board or committee work, but doesn't feel she'd be welcomed. Eva is 98 years old. She lives alone in a studio apartment in a large metropolitan city. She has no children. Her only cousin is dealing with her own aging issues. Eva spends her days quietly. Despite her very limited vision, she takes pleasure in reading large type books for a short period each day. She's proud that she continues to keep a kosher kitchen. Although she was once a regular shulgoer, she does not get out without help. So her only other religious observance now is saying Yizkor, which she does using a siddur she was once given, which she can barely make out because of her poor eyesight. Sarah is 52 years old. She's married and has three teenage sons. She's a busy and accomplished professional at the top of her field. Yes? She is also caring for her 78-year-old mother. Sarah's mom was living independently in a condo in South Florida until she was found wandering in a nearby development. In an instant, Sarah dropped everything, closed up her mother's home, and took her mother up north. Now her mother's in an assisted living facility, and Sarah's busy life includes managing her mother's health care, frequent visits, worrying about and grieving her continuing decline. Sarah has trouble sleeping and worries that her marriage will suffer. So what can Jewish life offer Stephen, the newly retired executive? Barbara, the lawyer in what is called extended middle age? Eva, the frail elder? And Sarah, the harried woman torn between caring for the kids and mother, career and husband? I'd like to look with you at the spiritual needs of elders and keep these individuals and all they represent in the broad spectrum of aging Jews in our minds as we do. So, al shlosha divarim ha'olam omed, let's look at the spiritual needs of aging Jews in the rubrics our tradition has defined as the hallmarks of a life of wholeness. Torah, lifelong learning, avodah, spiritual growth and engagement, gemilut chasadim, contributing talent and wisdom to community. Let's see how our communities and our congregation might facilitate lives of wholeness for elders across the spectrum. I want to tell you, as we begin, that the reflections I'm going to share with you are the product in part of a think tank that Hiddur, the Center for Aging and Judaism, held with the Union for Reform Judaism Sacred Aging Project about a year and a half ago. And a report from that think tank has just recently been released. And what you have today among the many materials that I hope you'll grab afterwards is an executive summary. This is the Reader's Digest version of a longer report that's available on our website, hiddur.org, H-I-D-D-U-R. So I hope that you'll take that and that it might be a tool in starting conversation in your community, in your congregation. So, Torah, the need to continue to learn and grow. Rambam says the following. Kol ish Mi'Yisrael chayav b'talmud Torah. Bein ani uvein ashir, bein shalem begufo, bein bal yisurin, bein bachur, bein she haya zaken gadol shetashash kocho. So every Jewish person is obligated to study Torah, whether they are physically whole or whether they are physically suffering, whether they are young and vibrant or whether they are very, very old and are failing in physical strength. And how long does this obligation go on? Rambam continues to say, ad yom moto, until we die. So we as a community have an obligation to foster and facilitate a life of continued learning for elders. Study can be absolutely salvific for those who are encountering the questions of meaning that come up in later life. And I'm sure if I asked you what those questions of meaning, what would you say? What are some of the challenges of, to a sense of meaning that come up in later life?
Illness, death.
I knew that was going to be first. How your grown-up kids are doing, and to what extent they're hewing to the course that you fantasized that they would take.
Is that all there is?
Are these the golden years?
I did have, there was a lady in the nursing home where I was chaplain for many years who had a mug that said, screw the golden years. Excuse my French, but.
Well, when you're dead, they say you're gone but not forgotten. When you're retired, you're forgotten but not gone.
Wow. So who am I now that I don't have this role? This is something that is, you know, if you've been blessed to have a role in your life that's so incredibly meaningful in your work life, how do you understand yourself when that role's gone? And if you haven't had a career that's quite as luminous as that, what if your definition of yourself has been in relationships that are no longer the same? So these are questions of meaning, and Talmud Torah is the perfect tool for reflection about them. I would like to suggest that Talmud Torah is a perfect tool whether or not it's been sustaining to a person earlier in life. I call to mind the aunt of my oldest friend, who was someone who was married to a non-Jewish person for her entire life, did not raise her children with a Jewish identity, and after she was diagnosed with terminal cancer, she joined a synagogue and joined the Torah study and went every Saturday morning and felt so incredibly moved to be a learning, growing Jewish person at that point in her life. So really, ad yom moto, this can be vibrant. I want to suggest that I don't think that Torah for elders means an older adult education class. The issue is access and integration and inclusion in the experience of study. The second thing, though, I want us to think about is how elders are given opportunity to teach their Torah. It's lilmod ulilamed. And I hope that teaching of Torah would be not just to kids in religious school, although Mela, that would be incredibly wonderful, but how about to those who are young adults and in between? Elders are, I believe, the precious resource for Jewish continuity. And I'm going to just share with you a couple of models of this that I've learned about recently. In a congregation in Durham, North Carolina, Rabbi Stephen Sager does something called Torat Zkenim. And over the last couple of years, they've chosen to honor a wise elder in the congregation, each one in a completely different way. So one woman was the cook in the congregation. This woman was known to cook for every synagogue event, and people got her recipes, and people knew her as that being her way of contributing to congregation. So the event that they did was they cooked her recipes. Anybody who was interested in cooking of any age in the congregation met in the synagogue kitchen and cooked her recipes and took down her recipes, and they then served what they had baked, I guess it was baking, for the shul kiddush. And at that kiddush, the service of that kiddush, this woman was honored with an aliyah to the Torah. And everybody who came to the service, I think, was given the recipes that had been baked. So I thought that was an incredible model. The next one was totally different.